We've got 50 minutes on the topic that is plaguing us most, and I am definitely going to dump content on you that I really believe can change the game if you implement it. So questions during are certainly good for me, and I'll absolutely leave time at the end. My name is Deidre Diamond. I'm the founder and CEO of CyberSN and Brainbabe.org. And this topic means a lot to me because I'm one of the rare people that walked into an environment that really cared about workforce development right out of college. I worked for the same serial entrepreneurial men for 21 years. One of those companies was Rapid7. And I walked into a story that was really about hanging together, throwing the rope over the fence. Nobody comes to work to fail. Train people, train people, train people, right? These types of concepts, which ultimately led to what I believe is love in the workforce. And so this model that I'm going to share with you today has been proven throughout my career, across the three companies, across my current company, across the companies that others that have grown up in the same plan that I am going to share with you today, in the companies that they've built. It is certainly going to be catered to cyberspeak so that we can adopt it a little bit faster. But this is really about humans, and whether it's cybersecurity or not, it certainly applies to our lives. So 50 minutes, and yet we can do it, right? So this is what we're going to get out of today. We're going to review the facts. Like, we've all got to get in tune with the true facts. There's some myths out there that we need to break. And I'm going to share a case study. While it didn't start out as a case study, it absolutely is a case study of my model implemented in a client through me, which is like the proven model on steroids as far as I'm concerned. We're going to actually roll out the model and then a 3 to 6 month plan for when you get back to the office. How many of you are in leadership or management today that are here? Raise your hand high for me. Okay, so the majority. Awesome. Awesome, awesome. And whether you've got a management title or a leadership title, to me, you're all leaders. You are responsible for other humans. And if you don't like that, you ought not take the title, because it's really not fair to those people. And so to you, I say, please, let's create workforce happiness. It can be done. I stand here today to say I've been a part of companies becoming public, companies going from 800,000 to 89 million in 5 years, running sales departments, overseeing technology departments. And while there are challenges and doing business with VCs and life insurance is out on my policy, on my life, I still had fun and love at work, and it can be done, and so did the people that work with me. So let's do it. Let's totally do it. It can be done, meaning you don't have to choose between money and successful projects and humans loving their jobs, right? We don't have to choose. All right, so let's get in tune with the facts, because the equation of these facts is critical to the understanding of where the opportunity lies. Although the facts are going to hurt your soul, there's opportunity within them, right? So how many of you believe 70% of the professionals, 70% of us are open to a change right now in our workforce? We all believe it, right? Like, you see the workforce unhappiness. We hear the talks at RSA, which this year we've seen many more of them about mental health, mental safety, right? So this stat speaks to we're doing a poor job at really embracing each other, supporting each other, growing each other. And it's funny, I'm not going to talk about diversity. I'm known to speak about diversity and inclusion, but I am going to tell you that this actually eliminates any issues with diversity and inclusion. And men are having it no better than women. When we see these statistics of how often you all change your jobs, then this is not something that is about diversity. It's truly just about being human. 62% of all people that have recently left their company said that they would have stayed if they had a positive workforce environment. That's crazy. All of your companies right now that you work for are trying to figure out how to retain talent. They're trying to figure out how to get talent, which actually is the problem, because you have to only figure out how to retain and you will get. You don't have to think about how to get if you know how to retain. And so, meaning I have never written a resume since I graduated college. So these statistics, while they're scary, there's opportunity in them. And I really want all of us leaders to really take advantage of this opportunity. I'm going to show you how in a minute. So here's the statistic about mental health, right? Like, it's getting worse, not better, actually. We're seeing more and more people talk about the challenges of actually making it within the cybersecurity roles. Part of that is human nature and how we all treat each other. Part of that is also how new cybersecurity is to the workforce and how reluctant organizations are to create the right budgets to support you all in having one job versus three. I liken it to IT in the early 90s, which is when I got into the business. And right, the IT person was under the desk doing our cords and our phones and our all of our wires as much as they were working with Excel spreadsheets and as much as they were on the telephones and VPN. It wasn't even VPN that back then, but you know what I'm saying. And today, we've invested massively in IT and certainly have created roles and responsibilities very specific. That hasn't happened yet in cybersecurity. If you're an engineer, you could be 10 different profiles, and yet we, you know, think of just one profile when we think of an engineer. An analyst, the same thing. GRCs, same thing. We have 35 job categories in cybersecurity and over 100 titles. So we are much more complex than the IT marketplace because we are the business of security, not the business of technology. Technology just falls into the business of security. And so we've got a lot of complications. We've got 25% higher than any other industry of the gap of humans. And yet, I'm sure you see this statistic and say, well, why is it so hard to find a job? Why, when I want to leave, do I have to talk to all these people that have no idea what I do? Why do I have to talk to all these people that have no idea what they want? And that's because of the complication. That's because of the digital era has complicated. The cost of content is free. There's a lot of reasons. Another conversation. Definitely plan on disrupting that myself with a new job platform. But until then, we are all dealing with a very, very serious broken job searching system that actually is the framework of this dysfunction. Because think about it. If you're looking for a new job, you're doing what? You're hiding behind the people that you work for, right? Like, meaning you don't want them to know, or even your peers that you love. Some of them you may love, some of them you may not love, but I bet you there's a few you do, and you have to hide. And that's really, as a human in our subconscious minds, really hurtful. And so while going through the interview process, you end up, most people, shouldn't say you, lots of people end up settling because they just want to get out of that dynamic of checking out of their own company. And if that isn't a vulnerability, right? Like, if we aren't our own vulnerabilities with these statistics, really, what is? So 14% of women have only been in their roles 5 years, and yet we expect to have women somehow rise through the chains so quickly without seeing a lot of women in roles. I'm lucky that I work for two serial entrepreneurial men. However, when I walked into the company, it was 18 people, there were two very senior women who I could look to. And as much as I look to those men, and I love them dearly, I look to those women, and I needed both. And it's a big reason why I believe my success has been what my success is. So these statistics really show us, let's see if we can get this next one, that we've got leadership issues, right? It starts from the top. I mean, all the way to the top. CEOs, board members, and down. That being said, we all have to learn how to manage up. Right? Anybody heard of situational leadership? If you haven't, check it out. It's been around since the Ford automotive days. It's a super powerful model, and it really shares on how to manage up. And we're going to have to manage up because it's not going to come down, or at least I haven't seen it come down. and so we have to look at this. Now, this stat, 24 to 48 months, well, that's a big, big range. It's the most recent. I like to use the most recent. Being that I own and operate the largest cybersecurity staffing firm in the U.S., I can tell you it's much less. I'm not the one that did the statistic, but I can tell you it's worse than what we see here. And even if it's 24 months, when I hire an executive, when I hire somebody senior, it takes me at least a year to get situated, and then another year to get progress. And so if we're leaving at 24 months, let's just use that time frame. It used to, ISC squared last year had 18 months, which is why I'm skeptical of this and my own data. Well, then, and if the job search for an executive, because there's only one usually, right, in a company, so that it's not as much opportunity, job search 6 months to a year, that means of those 24 months, 6 months to a year of it was job searching, which means not totally committed, not totally in performance mode. And wow, what a disservice to the company, what a disservice to themselves. And yet there's nothing that that person can do other than what they're doing to solve their issue of being somewhere where they're not taken seriously, being somewhere where they're set up to be a scapegoat, being somewhere where they're not given the budget. And you know, the interesting thing I've seen over the last year is that finally CISOs are getting the budget to staff so that they don't feel overwhelmed. And certainly that's what people are saying to get you all in, if any of you are in here, I'm sure you are. But what ends up happening is that you don't have a budget for a staffing agency. And that's a serious problem because your recruiters internal cannot speak cybersecurity, and they sure as heck can't get those people out there that want to be private to talk to them. So what I watch all my wonderful clients struggle and only get to use us for small burning needs, right? Put it in your own budgets. We'll talk about that a little bit later. All right, so 32% of the women are leaving within a year. STEM, totally true, totally true. Where are they going? Biotech. Healthcare. Actually, GRC falls into this, meaning in terms of where they are going, there's a lot of women that sort of have been in engineering. They're like, you know what, I'm tired of the not being heard, not being supported, feeling so alone. There's more people in law and GRC that are women. I'm going to go over there. These are statistics that haunt us today. All right, so let's look into this. If we're going to talk about retaining people, and all these facts are now swimming around our heads, what's the number one, before I switch the slide, what's the number one reason people leave their current work today? Who wants to yell it out? Leadership. 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 Interesting. Could that, and I would say that that turns into opportunity, meaning your leaders aren't showing you or showing us a way to move forward, a way to grow our skills, a way to get better. Human brains need that. We need it desperately. In order to feel alive, in order to feel happy, we must be feeling like we're learning and growing and achieving. It is a proven statement. And so opportunity is the number one reason people come to us. Then the number one reason when we knock on doors, people are listening. What do you got? You know, what would I be doing? What would my job be? Now more than ever are those the questions, because we've all taken jobs one too many times where we thought we knew what we would be doing, and then we get involved and we're not doing what we think we're going to be doing. So this is hugely important. Training is a part of opportunity, but you hear it, we hear it all day long. It sort of encompasses in this. And training isn't just getting to come to RSA. It is events like this, and it is important to be at these events, as we all know. But it's also certifications or just knowledge courses that don't have to turn into certifications, but the ability to gain knowledge and be supported for that. So what does that mean? That's not just money. That's also giving somebody the time to learn, giving somebody the time in their schedule to learn, right? And I'll tell you, this commute thing, this number three up here, is really serious. So our commute, our remote jobs that we post, we get 80% more response. 80! Like, this isn't like 10% or 20%, it's 80. And I firmly believe that an SME can work remotely. I don't believe that somebody can train entry-level people, junior folks from far away. I don't believe that that's the most productive way to do it. I do believe that SMEs can be remote. And I think we're doing ourselves a disservice in not looking at this. The companies that are really gaining the talent, especially in this industry, where the majority of the engineers don't necessarily love hanging out. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. So leadership and culture, you all said it first. I think it really ties all of this up together. That being said, it's hard to decipher, somebody's reason for leaving into one category and say it's just this. It always falls into opportunity and people. The commute is there for sure. That's something that people would love to have more time with their family. If you're in the car less or on the trains less or on the planes less, then you're more time with your family and your friends. Of course. However, what gets them to talk to us, what gets them speaking about leaving a job is really truly the opportunity and the people, which is leadership, of course. And unfortunately, we all know that one person can ruin it for everybody. We've all worked at somewhere where there's just one person that just wasn't possible to continue working with. Or it could be lots of people, but it only takes one. So who cares if it's one or more? If it's one, it's enough. So, all right, we've seen the statistics. You're like, where's the opportunity? What are you talking about? This sounds horrible. And actually, in many ways, it is horrible. And yet, here's the opportunity. All right, so this is the perfect storm. If you're a leader that really has a story, that you're planning on taking care of the people that work for you. You're planning to make sure that they achieve, they develop, they grow as a human, and they're supported in mental safety to make mistakes. And they're supported to think out loud. And they're never spoken to rudely. If you are that leader and you can do that and still hold people accountable, which we'll talk about in a minute, and still be productive, well, then you can pick up 89% of the market right now. Because that's what the market wants. And that is exactly how I choose my clients and how my leaders in my organization choose our clients. If we walk in and you don't have that story, you either create that story before we do the search for you, or we're not interested. For two reasons. One, we're humans and we're not interested in just making money for making money. And number two, they're friends. We become friends. Been in this community a long time. I'm a social criminal justice major. I take this very seriously. I have serious problems with the lack of seriousness that this industry gets in these events and what goes on in the show floor and all kinds of stuff. It's another day. This is very serious stuff. And so if you're that person, you can fill all your jobs. There is no way that any one company can say that they can't fill their jobs because there's a shortage. I call BS. I call BS so much that I'm willing to solve and fill all of those jobs within 30 days because of this statistic. If you've got the story that genuinely says you care, which means you're prepared to sell opportunity. You're prepared to discuss succession planning. You're prepared to discuss what kind of training and opportunity you're going to give. And if you're not, you ought not hire until you do. Because otherwise, you'll be chasing your tail, bless you. Like everybody else, you'll be chasing your tail. And this is what I see all day long, you know, all this effort to hire, 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 no plan to keep, no plan for succession planning, let's lose them in a year at the most, and then let's do it again and again and again. I'm 5 years into this. This time, in terms of cyber, I did 13 years in IT and software, built two software companies in between. Nothing has changed, it's gotten worse because of the job searching platforms being content is free. And that's another story, but it is the truth. So here's the opportunity. You can find these folks. You got to have your story and be ready to sell. This is what people want. Where did this concept get lost? I'm always thinking to myself. And recently, I found myself really remembering the 90s when everybody stayed at their jobs a long time. Like, how many of you, your parents, were at the same company, or those a little bit before us at the same companies for long times? Retirement was the play. Pension plans was the play. And when I got into the business in January of 94 as a fresh graduate, that was the play. And then guess what happened? And sort of, you know, thinking about it just recently, .com. So when .com came and the need for engineers, well, guess what story everybody had to sell to get people to leave? It's good for you to leave. You shouldn't stay at your company more than 2-3 years. That's how you make more money. You gotta move to make more money. And partially, that is true. So that is very, very true. So no money was on that list. Nobody comes to my firm and says, I need to make more money. That's exactly why I'm leaving. Doesn't mean they're happy necessarily about the money they're making. Doesn't mean they don't want a raise to make a move. It's just not what started the conversation. But fast forward down to offer stage. If there isn't a significant increase or significant advantage, why would anybody take the risk of the possibility that the grass isn't greener? Because we've always seen that it's not half the time. So nobody does make the move without the money. But it's not what started the game. So when we lost this, sticking together matters, let's retire together, let's build things for long term in the .com. And I happened to come, you know, into a story that was saying the opposite. And I thank my lucky stars every day that I met these folks. Never mind that I'm a woman having had met these folks. So this is what people want. Everybody in this room wants this. So why wouldn't we, even the people above us who are doing terrible jobs at this, they want it too. So let's bring it up. Like, let's make it happen. And I'm going to give you the model, and we're going to talk about it. It's not as difficult as people think. I said this statement earlier. This was the statement I was born and raised in terms of business and the gentleman that really mentored me. And I believe it. I believe it. Like, what does this mean? You know what this means to me? It means conflict is love. And I learned this not too long ago. It was in my mid-30s, and I took a class, an empowerment training class. And I was brought up that confrontation's bad. I actually wasn't really good at confrontation. In fact, I'm still not that great at it. I avoid it so I don't have to deal with it, meaning I'm ahead of it. I'm ahead of my people 10, 20 steps because I do not want confrontation, right? Honest to God. And yet what I learned in my 30s was that confrontation is love, because if I'm willing to confront, if I'm willing to stick in the conversation, if I'm willing to play the conversation out no matter how hard it gets, then that's love. Because the opposite is walking away. The opposite is shutting down the relationship. The opposite is bad karma. Bad relationships, right? Like, we're not friends anymore, so to speak. And or we're going to pretend like we're friends, but we're not. Because we didn't stay in the conversation. We took our ball. We went home. So I really want and challenge all of you to recognize that we've got some mindsets to change, right? We've got quite a few of them. I'm going to go through some of more of them today. This is one of them. Meaning, sticking together is actually good. It doesn't mean lower productivity. It ought not mean lower income. It will only mean those things should we choose to believe them, right? Because we all know that when we believe things, they become true. When we believe and say things out loud, they become true. So here's my cyber speak, such that we can adopt this a little bit faster, because I'm sure you're all aware of these terms up here: identify, backup, monitor, and update, right? Like, it's ingrained in your souls, and it's what you're thinking about 24/7. And so my ask of all of you is to add the human workforce hygiene to this same model and apply it the same way. And I'm going to walk through how we're going to apply it. But that's my ask. My ask is to recognize that the human piece must be applied in the same way. And when doing so, we actually create the environments that create equality, inclusion, development, and happiness comes as a result. And so if you're going to identify your workforce, the first thing you need to do, and this is where we err all the time, right? How many of you have read a job description that tells you nothing about the job, i.e. the role and the responsibility? Instead, you see a list of 3 to 5 years with Python, 3 to 5 years cloud, hell, let's put it 10, you know, right? Like, we've got these just lists of what skill set is what has become job descriptions. And so because of that, there isn't law and order, if you will. There isn't this, everybody understands what everybody's doing, but most importantly, myself, so that I can see if I'm succeeding or not succeeding. So the first thing one must do before you ever hire, don't hire again, don't do anything about hiring until you do this. Sit down and document your roles and responsibilities down to the projects and the tasks. Not high-level fluff stuff. What projects and tasks do you need done? This is the most important thing you can do, because it is the projects and tasks that are actually the act of working, right? Not the theory of we're trying to get somewhere. And so with that, you apply a measurable agreement. And this is where it gets super, super transparent and the environments will run themselves. If your roles and responsibilities are defined by projects and tasks, and you actually create an agreement to each project and task that is measurable, such that when it's due date time for that project or task, it does not come down to power of who's right or who's wrong. Did they do it? Did they not do it? It's so easy to know because there was a measurable agreement. This can be done. This absolutely can be done, even if the measurable agreement is, I can't make it measurable right now, so we're going to go do X, Y, and Z for the next 2 months, and we're going to make, that's measurable, and then we're going to make something measurable. Meaning, this absolutely can be done, and you must confirm it with everybody on the team. Everybody's got to be on the same page. And when you do so, and you document, and you have a policy for change control, you will have a calmness about your business and your group and an understanding. And people can achieve and move and flow and get work done because they can see it. They know exactly what it is. And what happens also is that they can see where to go next, right? And we're gonna talk about that in a minute. Instead of putting, what was my, oh, that we all want the same thing. Okay, so I just messed myself up. But anyhow, having a plan for talent loss is number two. So you define your roles. You make them based on tasks and projects. You put your measurable agreements to them. And then you've got to have a backup plan, because we are in business, and things do happen, and not everybody can achieve in certain environments, and maybe people aren't in the right seat, and you need to readjust. So you must have plans. This is business, and we are in capitalism, and people will hold people accountable. And so you got to have a plan. What consulting firms are you going to use? Know them. What staffing firms are you going to use? What are your internal resources? Are they prepared to replace the work of somebody, meaning the team coming together and thinking like this? It could be a disaster recovery situation, health, death, emergencies in families. Everybody understanding each roles and responsibilities that are measurable, plus having a plan if somebody's out of what's going to go down, how we're going to augment, will keep you running. Because you'll have it ready, just like you do in your dealing with your technology. You know exactly what you're going to do when things go down. At least I think we all are at that place. Yeah. So monitoring, right? I was going to do monitoring number two is where I got my a few minutes ago tripped up here. But then I realized, you know what? Like, if you don't have a backup plan, who cares about monitoring? Because your plan isn't going to work. Meaning you will have disasters, you will have situations, and you need to be ready. That being said, provided you have that, now we're monitoring, right? So these seven things are what we all want. These are what you're monitoring. How do you monitor them? You just have the conversation of, do you feel valued? Do you feel supported? Do you have measurable agreements that you agree with, right? Is your career path, do you see it? Do you know where it's going to go? And being willing to have that conversation, even if you as the leader don't know where it's going to go, you don't have all the answers, that's okay. We're all humans, we get that, but it doesn't mean we don't have the conversation. By not having the conversation, we're actually doing ourselves a disservice. It's telling people you can't see past 2 years, you can't see past 3 years, that's okay. You have time to get to that as long as you're in the conversation. Now, in my organization, if people are entry level, this is weekly. If they're junior in their careers, it's monthly. If they're more senior, it's quarterly. It's not necessarily as defined as this, and it's happening. I'm at a dinner, a lunch, a drink, even though I don't drink, having my iced tea, something every day. And so are other leaders. And nobody takes a leadership role in my company unless they're interested in doing this, unless they're actually interested in caring for a human and for lots of humans. And so if we can get our heads around we all want the same things, then we can have these conversations easily and not be afraid of what the answer is going to be. Don't be afraid of somebody being unhappy. Be excited that you found out, because you can help them. You can change it. You can get ahead of it now instead of being surprised when they quit, right? Like, that's the last thing you want. It's the total last thing you want. All right. We all can be updated. I don't know what version I'm on, but I know there are versions. Many, many versions. And even though I feel like my career has been very successful, it doesn't mean that I didn't need updating, that I didn't need to create newer versions of myself. And so the way we do that as humans is certainly certifications and degrees. It's the number one thing that people think about. And also business acumen. I mean, my goodness, in the early 90s when I got into tech staffing, I was told, you must ask the question if this person could be in front of other people or are they just going to be in the back room? No joke. That was a part of my job order question, because 95% of the people in tech were not capable of being in meetings, interacting with clients, even interacting with executives. And that went on for about 10 years. And then it flipped to geek is chic, right? But only because you can communicate and had business acumen. And yet, none of our colleges are teaching it in a computer science degree or a tech degree. Has any of your companies sent you to communication skills training, business acumen training? Raise your hand. How many of you have gotten that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 out of, what do we got, 50 in here? How are we going to achieve? We've moved into a service economy. We might be in tech, but we're in service before we're in tech. We must work on teams in order to achieve. There are no siloed one individual roles anymore. You can't lock people in the back room and have them develop for 6 months and then come out of the room. That doesn't exist anymore. And so we must have this type of training. Win-win communication, lean language, dealing with conflict. And we must have it more than once. Like your tech training, the reason why you're so good in tech isn't because you went to school and then it just happened. It's because you practice it every day and you became an SME in it. We must practice our business acumen every day. And yet most of us don't have that access to that type of training, which is why I really encourage you all to get it. Gone are the days that it's just salespeople that are supposed to have the communication skills. It's over. And yet this is really getting in our way. I mean, we struggle communicating to the people above us, our needs, what security even is, why it's important, never mind the day-to-day, just how we interact with each other. They're two different things, and yet they all require the same skill set. When I think about updating, I think about the leaderships or leadership updating themselves too. And yet they're not going to just do it on their own. You can update them, meaning you can have the conversations about what you want to update in yourself, and it will trigger them. Humans, we're like, we've all heard monkey see, monkey do. It's pretty universal. We really, it's, you know, we don't know what we don't know. You know, it's the same thing. Like if you get a human thinking about something like communication skills and working in an environment where people can be very productive and happy, they'll actually follow because it feels good. It feels good to talk about these things versus broken things, you know, negative things. So recognize that leadership and inspiration from leadership will occur if we're updating ourselves. We will inspire people above us, for sure, for sure. All right, so here it is. How many of you are like, yeah, right, I don't have time for this, or let me tell you all the things that are gonna get in your way. I'm gonna tell you them all so that when they pop in your mind, you can say, nope. I'm getting rid of that excuse or myth. Call it what you want. I think since I led with the word excuse, I'm going to choose excuse. I can tell you that, you know, where there's a will, there's a way. And if the will is 100% commitment, you will achieve implementing that model. You have to commit to it. And you cannot let these excuses get in your way, right? Like, you don't have the budget. I don't have the budget to create my succession planning, my you know, human workforce plan. So I don't know how to tell them what it's going to be like in a year or 6 months or 2 years or 3 years. I covered that earlier. So you have that conversation and you work like heck above you to solve that. But you're honest about that. You're having those conversations. You're including your team in those conversations and you're creating what you want in those conversations. But don't let money and budget get in your way of having these conversations. Just having the conversations will change your culture, right? What else do we got here? When I train, they leave. I hear this still today. How many of you hear this? Yeah, right? Isn't that trippy? I mean, that literally says that humans are just waiting there to get training and leave. Well, maybe if they're in training and they don't like where they're working, yeah, of course they're gonna finish the training and leave, but they didn't leave because you trained them. Right? They would have left if you didn't train them. What did I say the number one thing is? Opportunity, right? So this is nonsense. We've got to get this out of our brains. New mindsets. It's not true. People don't. You're not going to train somebody and they're going to leave just because you train them. Or you shouldn't not train them because you think they're going to leave. You're actually creating them leaving by thinking that, right? You're actually creating that vibe. And people and leaders do still think this. There isn't time for succession planning? No, there isn't. So make it. Your employers don't make time. Every time we take a new intake for a leadership role, chief information security officer, VP, director, my team knows, send me the job description. Because if there isn't time for management of staff, don't work that job. It's not done. We're not ready. Like, you're not thinking about the percentage of time that this person must spend managing the team, implementing this model, spending the time, creating the answers needed to be successful and happy. And so it must be in your job description, or you're going to start off in the wrong foot. So if it's not, get it in there. Whoever's interviewing you, talk about it. Make sure you're working with somebody that understands there's a large percentage of your time must be spent on this. Or don't take that job. Send it back. I can't pay what others are paying, which means I can't retain people because I can't pay. Not true. Not true. We see people take small pay cuts to take a better opportunity. What is $5,000 or $10,000 over the course of 12 months and over the course of taxes in worth in terms of happiness? Not much. Not much. A couple hundred bucks. That's not worth happiness. So it's not true that you can't compete. People, especially the technologists here, do not go to work for the money. That's not what happened. Of course, we all want to get them paid, and we need money to keep ourselves out of harm's way and put a roof over our head and educate our children. And yet, that's not what keeps us going to work every day, solely. Working for home isn't productive. I talked about that earlier. I don't agree. Again, if you're an SME, it can be very productive. It's all in how you manage. And moving on is good for people. We covered that earlier. I think we've learned that it's pretty much a myth because we have more mental health challenges today than we did in the early days of our business, of tech. And certainly cyber isn't only tech by any means. However, it's certainly what started us through here. And so this is a myth. And I like to say it's an excuse. So that whenever you think this, challenge yourself to replace it with a new mindset, a mindset that says the opposite, actually. Otherwise, we are literally making these myths come true. And I see it. I see it. Those companies that tell me, you know, I'm not going to invest a lot in training because the people just leave every 18 months to 12 months. I'm not even going to touch that account. And I tell them that, so hopefully it helps and people can learn and change. But I'm not going to touch that. This is not true. But they're creating it. Because guess what? That's what's happening at their company. People are leaving every 12 to 18 months. So, you know, it's the brain, the subconscious mind runs us. It's only like 2% of our brain capacity is running at a conscious level at any given time. We're running in our programs, right? This brain is a program. And it finished getting programmed at 7, according to scientists. And it'll stay running in that program unless we wake it up. Which is why speaking what we want, putting things out there that we want to create, saying actually wakes up the conscious mind. Otherwise, your subconscious mind is creating all those myths. And they become reality. Because this is the reality. This is the cyber statistic. The 89% was all of tech. This is the cyber percentage of 70%. This is reality. So if this is reality, then we need to counter reality with a new mindset. It's not the wage gap. I mean, it's not the talent gap. It's not because we're short people. But guess what? That has given us a really nice excuse to have cultures that aren't about taking care of each other. It's given us a really nice excuse because we're short so many people. Therefore, it's not us. It's not our environment. It's not the company. It's the marketplace. Come on. No human wants to be job searching every 12 months. It's the worst experience ever, isn't it? I mean, it's terrible. It's awful. So that is exact opposite of the reality of what humans want. All right, I'm going to share that quote case study. It's a case study after the fact because it sort of hit me after it happened. So about 3 years ago, I got a phone call from a Fortune 500 individual asking me if I would do contract employment. And I had never done contract employment. I'm a perm specialist. I didn't like contract because I didn't like the way contractors were treated. I thought that that was a business that didn't interest me at all. And I told that person that. I don't want to be a part of that. I'm not interested in people being used and abused and all that stuff. And this person said to me, no, this is a CapEx, OpEx thing. This is not that we want to treat people differently and we won't treat them differently. I'm like, I dug on that and I said, okay, let's do it. Let me go help this client out. I really liked this person that called me. I really appreciated their mindset and how they were speaking. And I said, okay, I know that I can create a program like that. So I created a CyberSN contracting program, make sure everybody has benefits, training, all that stuff. And I told that person, if I'm going to do it, you're going to pay for it, meaning I'm going to bake in training, I'm going to bake in time off, I'm going to bake in sick days, I'm going to bake in healthcare into these hourly wages so that I can feel like a good person when I go do this for you. And will you pay for that? Yes, yes, yes. So we go do this. Over 10, just so that nobody needs to know who the heck I'm talking about. All in the sock. Beautiful program, beautiful experience, lots of great work getting done, year and a half into it, major leadership change happens. And we put all those people in within 6 months. Then they were there a year and a half. So some of them were there 2 years, right? Massive change at the top of the department, not the top of the company, not the person everybody thought was going to get the job. Lots and lots of upset, lots of people really upset. People have been working for this person that didn't get the job for 10, 15 years, brought somebody in from the outside, right? The age-old, ridiculous stuff. Oh my gosh, pandemonium set in. My phone was blowing up. Not just my contractors. In fact, they were less blowing up my phone. It was the permanent people. Guess why they were blowing up my phone? And more than the contractors were. Anybody got any ideas? The contractors had the workforce hygiene implemented. They knew that they had a place to go to. They had people to talk to, us. They knew their career was taken care of. They had their program of what was going to happen. And I said to them, hey, everybody, guess what? Change control happens in companies. If we're going to work in Fortune 500, we need to be prepared for it. We all came here for experience. Each one of you took this job to get better opportunity than others. Let's see what happens. Let's hang on. Let's show up like pros. Let's see what happens. Meanwhile, the head of the department out, right, of the group I'm working with, their peers out, all the perm people leaving. A couple of perm stayed, but almost all gone. All contractors there. And you know what? Our folks were the ones that were able to get the MSSP or the MDR that they brought in up and running. And had we not stayed, it would have never happened. And I'll tell you, we weren't treated well at all. In fact, I've never been treated more poorly in my life than this person that came in. And it took every piece of my soul to do what I did. And I wanted to, A, make sure I taught these people what it means to be in business and be professional. And C, I needed to give this person a chance. Like, I didn't know for sure that they were as awful as I thought. And so when I think about my experience with this proven model, it's been very proven over my 25 years of my career. And when I see others implementing out in the world, I get it. But I see it too, and I love it, but it's not much. But to actually see it in this capacity was fascinating. Absolutely fascinating, right? All of a sudden, these people who were treated like they were a part of the team were now treated like contractors for the first time. And it was yucky. But because we had each other, because we had a plan, because we knew that we could get out at any time and I could put them other places, we were able to show up like pros and see if it was possible to create something different, because you never know. It wasn't, we're all out today, that's okay. However, I'm super proud, and I know that the whole team is super proud of how we handled that situation, and I don't blame those perm people at all. It was time to go. So this isn't about, it only works if. We're humans. We want the same things, right? We talked about that. And if we have the same things, we can weather storms. We can get through things. We can show up and be productive, even in yucky times. And then there's a date when, for me, it was 6 months, when that was enough. Let's go on our way, right? So that's a fun topic to share. We've got 5 minutes, all right? And that's not good. So I'm just going to leave this up here. Somehow I was supposed to put hiring in this whole talk, too. I started with retention. If you have your plan, your job descriptions look like this, and you are really got your salaries in order, because that's the number one reason my firm gets our time wasted, is that people are off on their salaries, and all this work gets done, and over $10,000 to $15,000, we can't get somebody on board. Ridiculous. Have it in order. And follow these tips here, and you will hire. You will hire. People can understand what that job is. All my jobs look like that. That's done through technology, actually, question and answer conversation with our clients. Takes 5 minutes, and we have jobs that make sense. All right, so I want to leave time for questions. I'm not going to spend more time on that, or we won't have it. There's a mic right here. If anybody wants to come up and use it, I would love it. Who's got, yes? Were you going to say something? Come on it. Don't be shy. Come on it.
So I had to write this down because it was earlier. But you talked about the remote work, and you felt SMEs could work remote, but juniors not really. How do you manage the mentoring and the coaching of that? Because you need those SMEs and the more mature people to work with those juniors. So they're doing that over technologies and everything. So why could a junior not do that remotely as well?
Yeah.
So could you go into that a little bit?
Yeah, great question. So junior for me is entry level. Really, from out of school or just brand new hire to a couple of years. It doesn't really go over 2 years. And so I really believe, for me, I have done both models. And I've found that if they're entry level, I need them right by the people that are training them. If they've got a couple of years experience, I can work them remotely. But even so, a couple of years, if they were in the office, they'd grow faster. There's just, you get more from seeing and being, osmosis, if you will, from being around others. That being said, the compensate, video. Everything should be video. Don't have remote workforces and not use video. That's how you stay connected, how people can really understand the message because they can read body language, eye contact, you know? It's super important. I certainly wouldn't not hire somebody I wanted to hire. For me, I don't have to choose. I can find them in a certain location because I can take advantage of the opportunity. Yeah, totally. Yes.
Thank you. Fantastic talk.
Thank you.
So there's a national initiative on cybersecurity education, the NICE framework that NIST has. It has the workplace roles and knowledge, skills, and abilities. Do you like that framework?
I
if
do.
If you don't like that, you do like that framework.
I do. It's not as in depth as mine is. Man, it's better than nothing, and it's got some good content. Yeah, for sure. They're identifying tasks and projects in that. Yeah. Yes.
Maybe the mic will pick this up, so I don't stand up again. Do you have any of these resources available online or anything that you provide out?
Which ones? The workforce?
Plans, these ideas?
The slides will be available. Our 35 job categories and the titles is on cybersn.com. We will soon be releasing salaries attached with that. We're releasing a real-time salary guide such that we have real-time salary. And in terms of our job building technology and our profile building technology, we are launching a self-service version called No More, K-N-O-W, with the N-O highlighted at Black Hat. It will be a covert job searching platform with our technology tools behind it so that we can empower the world. I have no interest in 5,000 recruiters to still add to this this major problem we have. So, yes, I do. Yes. Great question. So in launch at Black Hat, it'll be U.S., and then second launch is international.
So that's for salaries globally?
No. Salaries will be U.S. Salaries will be U.S., and that's just in 2 months. Yeah. Great question. Who else? All right. Yep, one back here. Go ahead. Come on up. Don't be shy. We got 1 minute. A couple of minutes anyways. Who's going to Tina Fey, by the way? I can't wait.
Okay, great presentation. I was wondering in your process how you can make someone who is not having the 100% needed in cybersecurity but will be having the 20 or 60 or 40, I don't know, and you program the fact to grow into the future recruitment.
So I think the question is, and tell me if I'm correct, how do you bring people in who don't have a lot of cybersecurity experience?
Yeah.
So this is a big challenge that we have in the industry because our roles need somebody to be able to do tasks and projects today, and yet our schools aren't getting people out with the ability to do tasks and projects, and we must train. We must train internally, which is really what succession planning is. And on the slide of backup, the succession planning piece is all about what do you need to do to train people coming in, because we will not be successful if we're not training people without experience to learn in our environments and having a training program for them. Like, create your own training program. Have the people within your groups and teams provide that training. That's the best way you can do it. I grew up in an environment where we were in training meetings every day until you were in leadership. And then when you're in leadership, it was once a week. And it's still that way in my company today. So meaning, and it's all of us training each other, you know, is what we're doing. And as people come up, we let them do it too. It's status quo. Yes.
How do you compare the issue of the retention recruiting cybersecurity with other IT area?
IT is about 15% of a gap, so IT has the same problem. In general, the United States has not done well at grooming our own humans in terms of workforce. We went overseas, right? We all remember when that happened. And when that happened, we stopped training here. And that was a capitalism move, and we're paying the price for it today. And it's affecting IT as it is all STEM jobs. You know, our youth are majoring in jobs that, or you know, majors that aren't STEM. And even for me, being brought up in sales, I wish STEM was pushed on me, you know, or sold to me. Not even pushed onto me, sold to me. It would have made my life a little bit easier. Awesome. I'm getting the stop sign. We'll publish all this. Thank you. It's a pleasure.